We do the microphone thing.
Great. Thank you ever so much for this invitation. I also understand it's a real opportunity for all of you to network, so I always feel kind of honored when I'm sort of the after-dinner mint, but it's really the excuse for people to get together and make those connections, which I hope I can show is not a totally superfluous activity when we're talking about resilience. First of all, can you hear me? Everything okay in the back? The cheap seats? Yeah? Okay, great. What I'd like to do quite briefly is to give you a little bit of a teaser about some of the key ideas about this notion of resilience, and particularly try and implicate you in how the work that you're doing actually affects the resilience. I'm going to focus mostly on younger adults and sort of older teenagers, older adolescents, and young through that sort of phase. When it becomes a little bit more about adults, say over the age of 25, 30, that type of thing, it changes ever so slightly the conversation. But so I'm going to focus a little bit there. But I will also be around all day at the event to take questions. Don't hesitate just to come up and chat. And I'd be very curious to hear some of your experiences as well. Let me start, though, at a completely different place than university. I was thinking about how to begin this, because, I mean, you're all experts on working with your particular population. Just as I'm at my own university, I've done advising and stuff, work as well. But I thought I want to take you back to grade one for a second. And I was thinking of, you see, the theories I learn about come from all kinds of absolutely amazing young people all over the world. And a while back, I met this six-year-old. Well, actually, I kind of met her through her mother. See, I have a clinical practice, and back then, the mom did was she basically dragged her six-year-old into my office and sort of pushed her in front of me and said to me, "Fix the little thief." You know you're going to have a good day when, right? So now just think about it. In a metaphor, I want to sort of tell you a story about a six-year-old little thief, and perhaps there's some lessons for us to learn when these same young people are 16 or perhaps 26. So there's this rather nondescript little girl. She doesn't look like Honey Boo Boo. She doesn't have the personality of Honey Boo Boo. She's just kind of one of these quiet, invisible children in her classroom in grade one. She doesn't have many friends. Mom is quite stressed at home and ignoring her. There's a younger child at home as well. And what had happened was, in this kind of very lame situation, this little girl had decided that she wanted friends, she wanted to connect. But she had so few resources to do it. No one was really paying attention to her. No one was facilitating those connections. So she took matters into her own hands and decided that what she would do is sneak off the playground at lunchtime. She was in a little elementary school. And she would sneak off the playground, go across the street to a 7-Eleven store, and steal candy. She found one of those little brown paper bags, and she put all the candy in and everything else. And then she realized, or figured out somehow, that if she stood beside an adult, as that adult exited the store, that somehow nobody suspected her of stealing candy. And this went on, supposedly, for 2 or 3 weeks. And then she'd go back to the playground, and she'd begin to hand out the candy in the corner of the playground. And, of course, she had friends. There were tons of children around her chewing. It was just a great experience. And in a sense, she solved her problem. She got status. She got a presence in the school. She had connections. Now, unfortunately, about after 2 or 3 weeks of this, somebody on the playground happened to notice, one of the monitors noticed that there's something not quite right here, realized what she was doing, called the mother. And, I mean, the mother was just horrified that this was happening, absolutely certain that this was just the first step for her daughter. You know, next it was going to be, you know, drugs, and then hanging out with Rob Ford, and then it was going to be, you know, it was just going nowhere for this kid. So she dragged her in and asked me to basically fix her. And it was quite simple to intervene. I started the conversation by asking the six-year-old, well, what happens when you steal the candy? And, of course, the answer was quite simple. She said she had friends. So I said to myself, well, how do we shape her environment so she has social connections? Now, we can't force friends on a child. You can't make a child have friends. I've never been successful at that. But I can give children a whole bunch of capacities that make people more attracted to them. such as, you know, a certain status in their school, a sense of personal identity, a certain pride, a certain sense of capacity, and all these kinds of things that draw people to us. So what we did was we worked with the school, and we had this little girl basically twice a week for a couple of months. One of the teacher's aides in the junior kindergarten would come up to her class in the grade one, and even though this kid was not very academically inclined, there was a little knock on the door, and this little girl, the little thief, would have to sort of get up out of her desk because she was being called out of her classroom in front of all the other kids, and she was being asked by the teacher's aide, could you please come down and help us with the younger children? We need some help to teach them their numbers and their colors and that type of thing. And if you can imagine John Travolta in Saturday Night Fever, if some of you, actually, are any of you old enough to remember John Travolta in Saturday Night Fever? And do you remember that sense of, that when he's walking down the street in his white suit and the Bee Gees music behind, and there's that sort of, that John Travolta, you know, he's so good at that, sort of puffed up, and that sort of, you know, that sort of walk, right? She walked out of her classroom like that. There was something magnetic about her after that. And she didn't have to steal candy to have a place inside of her, in a sense, her community, her school community. The problem was relatively easy to solve, but I learned from that experiment, if you will, some key ideas about what makes us resilient. Let's face it, the kids that you're going to, when you get to be 50, I think you can call them kids, right, when they're 20s. The young people that we're working with, you know, there's a whole lot of challenges that they're coming to and facing. You have a lot of challenges, you know, with the young people. Of course, you know, we know that there's addictions issues. There's an incredible amount of expectations on young people. There are financial problems. We also know, for instance, that amongst Canadian students attending universities, about, 82 to 83% will go on to some other post-secondary education after they complete their BA or BSc. That, in fact, what we're seeing is this constant sort of expectation to go further, financial challenges, and that's, of course, coming and being accentuated further by, of course, anxiety disorders related to overprotective parenting and maybe not necessarily being asked to mature as fast as many of you may have been when you were growing up. So this confluence of problems is begging for us to look at the factors that actually can promote capacity in young people so that when they hit a stumbling block, that they don't turn to easy, necessarily deviant solutions like quick to solve, you know, if you're stressed by an exam, that you plagiarize the results off of the internet. How do we encourage young people to sort of have the capacity to do well without necessarily accentuating their disordered behaviors? When I think about resilience, I follow a two-factor model of mental health, which is what's up above here. And this notion is from the World Health Organization, and it's been well validated by researchers like Corey Keyes and others, that simply says that we can think about mental well-being not just as suppression of disorder. So you come through a great trauma and you don't show post-traumatic stress disorder, right? You have been, God forbid, sexually abused, and you don't show a decline in your functioning related to some psychological problem, depression, that type of thing. That's one type of criteria for resilience. But really, I think what we're actually understanding is what we need to do is not just suppress disorder, but we need to develop people's capacities. We need to ensure that they have social connections, thinking back to the six-year-old little thief, quote-unquote, right? That you need to have a sense of powerful identity. You need to attribute the causality of your life, a sense that I can control my world. I need to have a sense that I can attribute that somewhat to myself. There's a whole constellation of factors which are particularly important to us surviving and thriving the next time we hit a stumbling block. Now, there's a problem with this, however, is that if you actually think about resilience as something that is only internal, so if we just give people internal capacities and somehow that's going to make them more resilient, I think we've sort of misunderstood what resilience is really about. In fact, there are two terms, and somebody was asking me this before, there are actually two terms used in the field. One is resiliency, with the C-Y at the end, and one is resilience, with the C-E at the end. And resiliency has really, for the last couple of decades, been seen more as a set of internal qualities. It's about generally people in lower risk environments showing internal capacities, like a certain sense of internality that I can control my world, say, or a certain IQ, or a certain perseverance. All those internal character traits, which, by the way, largely you are not going to be able to change. The research is quite clear that really, largely, you have incredibly little capacity as interveners to change what are basically internal qualities of individuals. So generally speaking, I don't try and adapt. I don't try and affect resiliency. I try and affect resilience, which is engaging people in processes that are facilitated, that allow them to overcome adversity. And this is, I think, where we've kind of misunderstood this notion of resilience, is that actually, if you look at the research, if you look at all those big longitudinal studies done by Emmy Werner or Ruth Smith or Ann Mastin and a whole bunch of others, you see actually that an incredibly small amount of the change in individuals is accounted for by individual qualities alone. Most of the change, when a person is under stress, is accounted for by things like the counseling they get, the financial aid that's available to them, the stability of their housing if they're homeless and or suffering from a mental illness, the ability to have social supports, nurturing environments, mentorship. In other words, if we actually start thinking about this, we create resilience in people. It's not something which is mythically inside of them themselves, which is just welling up. And if it was, then we wouldn't need all of you. You'd be out of a job, right? Because it would be you'd be obsolete. I mean, just pull up your own pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. You know, get on with your own life. Let me just very quickly, I can actually show you this a little bit. If I took you to, we have research sites all over the world, but one of the places early on in this research was in Medellin, Colombia, home to Pablo Escobar. And they had a major problem with epidemic. World's highest rates of homicide for a time in the 1990s and early 2000s. And this is actually where I was doing some of the research. It was so dangerous, I couldn't even go into the community at first, and people would come out to meet me and the research team at one of the universities there. But what the community has done is they've managed to cut their homicide rate by 90%. They've actually addressed a very serious social problem, one of very really, really problematic behaviors. And they did it in large part, by changing the environment around people, such as by building a transportation system that allowed people to access jobs in the valley below. So these favelas were sort of built up on the mountainside, and what they did was they actually gave people access to things like public transportation systems, this gondola system, because they couldn't build any other kind of roadway system. So they put in gondolas that are whisking people into the valleys and allowing them to access jobs. It changed the economies of people's lives, and with the change in economy, gave them those intrinsic qualities, like hopefulness for the future. That people began to say to their kids, go to school, there is opportunities to get jobs now. It was a tectonic shift. It also sort of meant that what they did was they did things like put a library in the middle of what was once the most violent community on earth. When the municipality of Medellin, they had a very forward-thinking mayor, and when he thought about where to put the public library, he didn't put it in the nice downtown area. He went up onto the hillside, onto the mountainside, and he had a Spanish architect design this absolutely beautiful, black, state-of-the-art building, which you can kind of see behind there. And that building attracts young people. It creates a community where there's in very tangible ways, people and are getting what they need to do well. It swarms with children. It's absolutely quite a remarkable place to go and visit. It's actually where I took a few years later, I took my own kids down, because I like to take my children to the most violent places on earth. And it was relatively safe at that point to just go in and sort of visit this particular part of that particular community. But what it strikes me is that really the message here is that we can adapt environments to make people more resilient. A very small bit of data right from British Columbia from 2008, one of the adolescent cohort studies, that shows that, you know, we know that children who have been physically or sexually abused tend to report much higher rates of suicidal ideation. This is a given, right? If you've got a kid you're working with, they've been sexually or physically abused, they're more likely to be suicidal. We've known that for decades. Interestingly, what the research also showed was that if you ask young people, are you connected to your educational setting? Do you self-report as feeling connected to your school? the rates of suicidal ideation dramatically drop. So in other words, before we think about more individualized services for children who have suffered abuse, the argument when thinking about resilience from a more ecological frame is in fact that resilience is something that we can change and manipulate through changes in the environment. Before I'm going to offer a child who's sexually abused treatment, I'm going to make sure that they feel connected at school. And I hope you can begin to see my point of bringing these examples here, is that these are not what you're doing in terms of making young people feel connected to their university, their social communities, their identity as a student, is not just something that adds on to student success programming. It is a core element to young people sustaining their well-being. Once we think about well-being as not just academic performance, but also academic engagement. The two have to go hand in hand for a young person to do well. And it's for this reason, really, that I'm just going to sort of suggest that. I'm going to suggest that psychological resilience, then, is in the context when there has been some sort of adversity. Because I'm not just talking about strengths, right? We could just talk about very privileged people with, you know, they have no crises, and we're talking about strengths. But when there's adversity and stress exposure, what we're really then talking about is, well, helping people to become resilient means helping them, giving them the capacity to navigate to the resources that they need, right? And I like that word navigation because it implies, I mean, we're sitting beside the ocean here, right? I mean, you have to be able to navigate. You have to, it's not enough to simply say to someone, well, you know, do it on your own. Well, the point of what we can do is we can actually help people navigate their way to the resources that they need, which of course implies that there is somewhere to navigate towards. You can't put somebody in a boat in the middle of the ocean and say, navigate. And they say, well, where am I going? There's no islands nearby. There's no food. There's no water. There's no nothing. Like, what am I navigating towards? Resilience is about providing the resources that are well matched to people's needs so they can navigate in that particular direction. But therefore, it's also about our capacity to negotiate for those resources to be provided in culturally meaningful ways. How many of you have you ever had that experience where you sort of thought you were setting up a program that was needed for the community of students that you serve, and you went through all the work of sort of, you know, developing the program and getting the program tested and piloted and everything else, getting the money together, buying the Timbits if you're allowed to buy Timbits for the students or whatever you're allowed to buy, and you're sort of setting it all up and then, like, nobody shows up? Or was that just me? And I often think that over my career I've realized that sometimes we think we're helping people navigate, but we haven't negotiated enough with the stakeholders so that what we're providing isn't necessarily a really great fit. So I just keep coming back to understanding resilience. There's a lot of words up there. I just understand resilience as these double processes that we help people navigate and we help them negotiate for what they need. And when we do it well, they accept our invitation. Generally speaking, if we match what they want and need, they will accept our invitations to engage. But when we don't get it right, then they do it on their own, right? I love this little cartoon. I was going to use this for my doctoral thesis years ago. I thought this would just be my whole thesis. But my committee recommended something a little bit longer and more structured. The little fellow's up at the board, and I'm not sure if you can read it, but he's been sent up to the board because he's been bad. I'm sure you recall that from your own childhoods. And he's writing out, I will stop my obsessive compulsive behavior. I will stop my obsessive compulsive behavior. I will stop my obsessive compulsive behavior. And he reflects in his little head that it just doesn't get any better than this. And I love that simply because it does tend to emphasize that in the absence of being provided with opportunities. So if we're wondering why students are socially withdrawn, it's perhaps because we haven't made the environment safe enough for them to engage. If we're wondering about why students are turning to excessive amounts of alcohol or binge drinking or something like that, not that addictions don't play a factor in this, but also at some point we can also say, have we influenced the culture around students and how you go through a quote-unquote rite of passage when you come to university? Have we provided alternatives for rites of passage that don't involve excessive self-harming behaviors like alcohol and drug abuse? How have we as a community of concern influenced these kinds of things for kids? Now, so essentially what I'm saying is that resilience is this kind of navigation, it's negotiation, it's something that we can influence. I hope that point's relatively clear. But I also want to sort of challenge this notion, this kind of idea that resilience all looks the same. There's a tendency, I think, a little bit, for us to think of resilience in just one particular way, and that usually is called recovery. It's an important pattern that you'll see, right? You'll see a student who's coming through. You'll see someone who they hit a snag in terms of their development. Some tragedy happens at home. Maybe a parent has lost their job. A parent has died. They're maybe gone through a period of addictions or something like that. They failed when they thought they could never fail an exam, and all of a sudden they're marks and they're on academic probation or something. And the tendency is to see them coming through that, giving them lots and lots of supports as they're kind of hitting rock bottom, and then sort of bring them back to normal development, meaning they attend classes, they stop the addictions, they tend to hold it together, they form normal relationships. But actually, there are other pathways that people travel, and it's important because sometimes we don't see them. The one that, of course, is stellar is post-traumatic growth, which is kind of interesting. There is a phrase, there's a whole study on post-traumatic growth that says we actually come through adversity, we learn from the adversity, and we do better than we would have without the adversity. I'm sure in a room this size that some of you fit that typology, right? That Mothers Against Drunk Driving is a great example of that, right? You come through the worst of the worst, and you rise above it by integrating that into your life plan. Another pattern that we see is sort of more this minimal impact. And in fact, statistically, you're going to get a lot of students who can come through incredible amounts of adversity. And if you're listening to people like George Bonanno and others, you're going to hear quite clearly, people can overcome with minimal disruption to their lives. Our expectation that people are going to go into chaos is actually a bit of an artifact of our culture. A lot of people actually do quite well, including child soldiers, victims of sexual abuse, and others, if they generally have a set of supports around them and a community that sort of gives them certain types of messages, which I'll get into in a few minutes. But so you have that pattern as well. If I come down, though, it's interesting because sometimes you also see avoidant behaviors. Children, or young adults for that matter, will socially withdraw when they're burdened greatly by certain kinds of challenges. So when you get a student who is kind of not engaging with service providers, or perhaps not getting to their classes, or not doing all these other things, I know the tendency is to see that as problematic, which of course it is, because it's dysfunctional, it's lower than what is normative functioning. But sometimes I think we also have to ask, in the absence of other strategies being viable, can you cut the kid some slack and basically say, maybe this is what the kid needs to do? There are periods where avoidant behaviors are actually functional. For instance, children who are abused by their parents, emotionally abused by their parents, do better when they withdraw emotionally. You know, us counselors, we come in and sort of, oh, you should really be talking to mommy. Well, mommy is mean and abusive, and daddy is, you know, struggling with severe addictions and stuff. And you know what the best strategy is for that kid is just to emotionally shut down. So we sometimes miss that what we're seeing can actually be an adaptive strategy until we change the opportunities, until we make it more likely that the child, the young person, I should say, can access other ways of behaving. And therefore, I also sometimes look at hidden resilience. Hidden resilience appears all the time in our work internationally because we work with people all around the globe. And so sometimes you'll see very distinctly, very distinct patterns of behavior, often culture-based, which are signs of resilience. The typical one tends to be, for instance, in some of our research, we see very high expectations put on children, especially you can sort of stereotype. A lot of different immigrant groups go through this. It used to be, if you were of, say, Jewish-Canadian descent, there was an expectation, as in many other immigrant groups, of high expectations. Now you see that pattern particularly accentuated and epitomized by people like Amy Chow from Yale, who wrote the book, you know, the Battle Hymn of the Tiger Mother and stuff like that. You begin to see this pattern of what would we say, Asian-American, Asian-Canadian, high expectations pushed onto children. It's a bit of a stereotype because you see it in other cultures as well. But that notion that somehow that excessive push for a child to do exceptionally well is going to actually sometimes result in almost an obsessive compulsive orientation towards studying in which no failure is acceptable. And I'm going to argue that though it might look dysfunctional to outsiders, cultural outsiders, inside that cultural bubble, it can actually look quite normal. And of course, you have maladaptive coping strategies, which, let's face it, when you're completely up against the wall and you have no choices, then sometimes deviance or delinquency is actually one way that you cope. How many of you have worked with students who are online gamblers as a way of putting themselves through university? It's quite common. How many of you worked with young women who are in the sex trade as a way of putting themselves through university? A little more controversial, but happening, right? Obviously the topic here is not to promote those behaviors, but the point is that coping strategies can look maladaptive until we change them. Let me give you a story. I did a few years back work with a young woman when I was doing some advising, and she was, it's kind of interesting, she fit that model of the high-pressured Asian-Canadian background where her identity was somewhat, in that sense, hyphenated, and she wasn't, you know, she was kind of betwixt and between sort of one of these third culture young people. And what was interesting was that her parents had some expectations that the only things that she would study at university, of course, would be medicine, or law, perhaps, that might have been acceptable as a second. Engineering was a better choice. And those kinds of things were what was pushed, she was being pushed into. Am I echoing at all the realities on the west coast of Canada? Now, interestingly, what the challenge for her was that she actually wanted to be a forensic anthropologist. She wanted to go off to the Serengeti and dig up old bones and figure out histories of people and look at you know, basically dig around the earth and dirt and study anthropology and sociology and all this kind of stuff, which was so far off the grid for her parents that she couldn't quite figure out how to resolve that. So what she did was, and it was interesting, what she did, and we sort of talked about this, what she did was she actually began the process of going to university and taking basically the science courses that were headed towards medicine, but she peppered them with a dual major, which she never told her parents. She peppered them with a dual major in anthropology. And somehow or the other, she basically stayed at university long enough to get that sort of, get the credentials that she needed, and she lied. She outright lied to her parents. And you got to applaud that as a strategy. I mean, it's not like you normally counsel your students. Right? Okay, I think you have a little dilemma. I'd really like to make you more resilient, so I'd like you to lie. But the point being is that sometimes in those particular situations, she was very successful, but it involved her basically compromising some of what she was doing in terms of the truthfulness to others. So I guess what I'm understanding is that very much we shape environments. We created for that young anthropology student a context in which, I guess, basically she could succeed at what she needed to do, rather than becoming one of these very stressed, unhappy, potentially depressed and self-harming young women that we might have otherwise seen in our classrooms. So she made some choices. Maybe they were slightly deviant or different, atypical, but she made some different, she made some decisions, and we as a society, as a community, as a university, were able to facilitate that pathway for her. Now, so what I'm actually getting, of course, is that I believe when we're talking about resilience, what I'm really saying, of course, is that nurture trumps nature. When you get risk factors showing up in people's lives, it's much more important what we give them. Which kind of leads to a second key principle here, which is that there's a differential impact in what we provide. For instance, if you're a particularly if you're relatively well-balanced and happy and financially secure and you've got loving parents, whatever the situation is, and you've had reasonable amounts of challenge in your life and had responsibilities and maybe earned a bit of your money to pay your university, all those kinds of other things, you know, you're going to be just fine. And frankly, advising is minimal impact, right? Come on, let's be honest. You're going to have minimal impact on people. But the moment there's a stressors, and any of those conditions are not necessarily met, someone is coming out of a situation they've been bullied. They're a little less sure of themselves. Perhaps they're using university as a way of sort of self-discovery, an opportunity to break old patterns or break away from communities where they've been marginalized for whatever reason. Then suddenly university and the challenges of putting their life together here is going to be much more complicated. And my argument is that things like mentorship are going to have a differentially large impact. That you know, you really have to think about this carefully, that the programs we offer, sometimes, you know, we should offer them universally, perhaps because it destigmatizes them, right? But at the same time, understand that you're probably going to have the most impact on the people who are most at risk. Michael Rutter is one of the gurus of this field, sort of half-jokingly talks about adoption as an intervention. Adoption is absolutely great for kids who are being physically and sexually abused by their parents, right? You want them removed early, put into stable homes, and hopefully adopt it in a permanency plan that gets them through life beautifully. And there's so many great stories of kids where that is a solution. But adoption is a terrible risk factor unless there's a lot of trauma, right? I mean, when I was raising, I have two kids, obviously, I showed you pictures. When I was raising them, I mean, there were moments in which I wish someone would just adopt them from me. But I kind of realized that that would probably be a mildly traumatic event for them. And I think that we sometimes have to understand that there is an impact, that the resources that you're providing sometimes won't have that big an impact on kids with lower stress levels. But with higher stress individuals, you could be the only lifeline that they are experiencing. And this gets even more complicated if we begin to look at all kinds of patterns. And this is where it gets really weird when you start talking about resilience, because you've got to understand the context in which something manifests. Bruce Ellis and Thomas Boyce, I think Thomas Boyce is out on the West Coast here, have been looking at what they've talked about as orchids and dandelions. And their point is that if you take a child who has a very reactive personality, okay, so I'm back to the personality stuff that you can't really change much, but you have a very reactive, someone who's really hypersensitive to their environments, right? Generally speaking, and you put that kind of individual in a very, very supportive, high support, but very, very low stressed environment. So now imagine, okay, you have an absolutely loving, perfect family, right, with a lovely dog, and then you have you have all that together, and you have very low stress and very lots of support, and you have a kid who's really, really reactive and sensitive. The kid's going to do great. They're going to become an artist. They're Richard Florida's dream child, right? They're going to be inspired. They're going to have everything about that reactivity, that sensitivity is going to manifest in them. But you take that same child, it's interesting, and they call them orchids, right? Because as long as you maintain all that beautiful supports around them, they do fine. Orchids are very, very fragile, though, once you take away the nurturing environments, right? You plop them into universities without the same supports, and suddenly they wilt, right? Because they don't know. They've never been challenged. They've never been tested. They've never had opportunities to look after themselves. They've been so unstressed, so nurtured, that in fact, they're not ready for life. At the other end of the continuum, though, are dandelions, what they call, which kind of fits. And the idea of the dandelion, of course, is that they thrive in the worst of conditions. Look at my front lawn and you can see that. They will have that capacity to keep going despite adversity, right? And these are also highly reactive children, because a highly reactive child in a very bad environment can also do very, very well, the research shows, because what they are doing is they're maximizing their opportunities. They're looking around. They're reading people. These are the con artists, right? These are people who know how to manipulate systems. They know how to get what they need, because they're putting all that sort of creative energy in a dangerous environment to their own needs to make sure that they survive. Now, so what you have here is a kind of an odd situation where you can have a particular quality, which is actually maybe dysfunctional. I mean, we don't generally speak about high levels of reactivity as something that we want. And in fact, when stressors are relatively minimal, you know, sort of at the bottom of this curve, you have kind of just a normal family life, and you have a very reactive, highly sort of sensitive child who's constantly sort of trying to manipulate their environment, it can be a bad fit. It can be a bad fit in classrooms where you constantly get people sort of trying to manipulate situations, and there's just no need for such excessive, hyperactive sort of almost behaviors. The point being here is that when we look at a set of capacities, when you're seeing somebody come to you with a particular set of behaviors, I think the question we have to ask is, does the environment make good use of what they are able to do? And that, for me, makes us more resilient. It's, again, coming back to that notion of navigation and negotiation. Indeed, when we were doing this all around the world, so we're looking at, you know, whether I'm in, what's it, Tanzania, or if I take you to Jerusalem, or southern Florida, I could take you over to Ireland, I could take you to South Africa, I could take you to Palestine. What you begin to see is there are sets of qualities that are highly predictive of resilience. And these things, we as a community of concern can actually affect in children. Now, of course, as I've been saying all along, which pathway children travel to find all seven of these things and what it looks like in a particular context is going to make it, well, I'm sort of hinting at a very individualized approach to case planning. What I'm really saying, of course, is that we have to understand that our, if depending on what you're trying to provide a child, it's going to depend on the context in which that child is in. The seven things, though, that we see that young people, and I'm coming right up to about age 24, so most of our studies have taken place with children about 12 to 24. And what we see consistently in those patterns is these seven things predictive of resilience, predictive of a capacity to overcome adversity in times of crisis, times of transition, times of loss, times of stress, like a failed exam. Positive relationships are the first thing, and not just with their families, not just with their mothers and their fathers, by the way. That's a bit of the myth, right? We're talking growing networks of positive relationships with peers and supports and bus drivers and coaches and friends and parents of your best friend and all those kinds of people. We're also seeing that identity. Young people seem to do better when the world reflects back to them that, yeah, you are special. Like that little girl who got up in her classroom, and it was important that the knock came on the door when she was in the classroom, not at lunchtime. There's the audience. They're watching. She's walking. You know, it works. The third one is power and control experiences, the attribution of causality to ourselves, the fact that, you know, sense of internality. I can change my world. Do we give people coming to us the power to make decisions for themselves and then help them to make those decisions into reality? The fourth one is social justice, which is interesting because we work around the world with mostly marginalized populations, those who have experienced being pushed aside, perhaps because they're LGBT, they self-identify, or perhaps of a racial or ethnic background. Whatever the cause of that, we often see them wanting to answer the question, you know, I am treated fairly in my school, in my community. And I think sometimes we forget that. We're so quick to psychologize problems that we sometimes miss the social injustices. I think the bullying movements are good at that. Rather than just doing, you know, here's your 12 sessions on anti-bullying, we're now talking about changing entire school cultures. Right? Instead of just saying to people, well, you know, develop the self-esteem to make yourself fit in better to the dominant culture, we're actually saying, no, maybe we should actually be adapting the dominant culture and our course curriculum to reflect more the diversity of the students in our classrooms. Those things are not just superfluous. Those are actually creating the conditions which people feel like they're being treated more fairly. And when that happens, they are much more likely to withstand the stressors in their lives. The fifth element is basic access to material resources. I know some of you are financial counselors, if I've understood. And you think about it, your job is actually, in a sense, creating the conditions so that people get their basic needs met, so they can walk around the campus without being stigmatized by the quality of their clothing, unless you happen to be the hippie, trippy kids who want to look really like that, right? Because there's always this, you know, the subcultures and that type of thing. There's also the sixth factor we see consistently is if kids have had the people around them create a sense of cohesion. And by that it's like, you know, your basic spirituality, your sense of belonging, your chances to be very, very much integrated into people's lives. Those kinds of things, a sense of belonging is extremely important to helping people to overcome adversity as well. And of course, cultural adherence, especially for more people who are sort of more on the fringes, that sense of continuity and identity across time, across the sense that I know who my grandparents are, I have a sense of continuity in that regard. Now, here's the interesting thing. It's kind of like a juggling act to make people resilient. And this is, I think, where we forget as individual service providers. I know that, you know, many of you work in somewhat relative isolation, perhaps, in your departments. But the interesting thing is, this is not how resilience works. You cannot, and there's no evidence, that you can, in fact, affect resilience by working on such a narrow silo of intervention. To get all seven of these things adapted and to give people different pathways, to change their pathway from maybe an avoidance strategy to a more, you know, minimal impact strategy, to get them to actually use more socially acceptable means to cope in dangerous environments, there's seven things that have to be addressed. Now, of course, it's a bit like a juggling. Trying to juggle all seven is really difficult. You may only juggle three. But you have to work in collaboration. Resilience is not something you're going to be able to just do. So simply providing a kid with money who doesn't feel like they have any social cohesion at the university is not going to attach them to their courses and may actually simply lead them into feeling incredibly isolated and depressed and using that money to drink themselves into a stupor. Right? But it's that kind of pattern. In isolation, interventions tend to fail because, one, we're not helping people navigate to all seven or at least multiples of these, and we're not negotiating with them so that these are provided on terms that make sense to them, which is extremely, extremely important. Now, I want to give you a couple last key. There's a few other things about resilience which you should know. One of the things is that also, it's interesting too, that when you start adding up those seven things in people's lives and giving them pathways towards, you know, that we facilitate their pathways, what you begin to see is that resilience is cumulative. So a lot of universities provide access for students to residences, right? And in those residences, they provide supports to help kids transition smoother into adulthood. Those things accumulate, right? Which means that they're diverted, their risk impact, their risk exposure is decreased because then they're not as likely to be drinking heavily or those types of things, or at least there's a mentor closer at hand. When you accumulate resources, they snowball. And in fact, what the research is very clear is that as you add resources to a young person's life, there is a sort of an exponential growth to the impact on their capacity to withstand stressors, like a failed exam. And that's why the more that you all can work together across departments, the more likely you are to see the impact exponentially increased on the young people with whom you're working. The second thing is, of course, and I hinted at this so many ways, that the context and culture matter, right? If you have a young person who's failing out or something, sometimes the question is not a matter of individual capacity, it's the capacity of their complex networks. What messages are they receiving from home? The young anthropology student was receiving messages from home that were of one sort. If she dropped out of her program, it wouldn't necessarily be the failure of the university, nor would it be the failure of her. It would unfortunately be a failure of a family system, perhaps even a culture system, which promoted a certain set of behaviors. Now, how do you challenge that? There's always that element of discursive resistance, right? That we can engage with young people and say, well, where do these messages come from and how are you going to resist? Being is that when I do think the solution is always to look at all seven of those factors. So when I encouraged her to lie to her parents. I didn't quite encourage her to lie, but we kind of got there. It was because all seven of those things were particularly part of the formula, weren't they? Right? That we were looking at, well, we want, like, if she didn't lie, she would lose the cultural connection. If she didn't lie, she was going to lose her relationships with her parents. And those things counted in her life. She needed them. Not to mention they were footing the bill for her university, so if she didn't lie, then she wouldn't get the money. So when you think of it in more complexity, it would have been so easy to say to her, I really want you to go home and stand up to your parents, right? And in some ways, I negotiated that with her, and she told, kind of like a game of mirrors. You ever seen, you know, like she's kind of like, you know, she's my mirror. She's kind of saying, Mike, you know, I don't want to go over there. And I'm saying, come on back, follow me. You know, we're sort of palm to palm. And she's kind of going, you got to understand it from my world. If I go home and try and convince him of this, it is not going to fly. So we lied. It wasn't an ideal solution, but we lied. Now, in a sense, that's, for me, understanding context. That helping people cope as best they can given the resources that they have. And, of course, the last strategy, though, the thing we also know about resilience is that long-term some strategies are not good. For instance, lying when you're 19 and you want to go to anthropology school makes sense. Lying when you're 23 and wanting to go to a master's at Johns Hopkins to continue your studies, that's a problem. And that's when lying doesn't work anymore. That's when you begin to need to stand up. That's when you need a different intervention, right? That's when you need to help someone focus on other aspects of resilience, like power and control, social justice, voice. What I'm hinting at, of course, is that we have a dramatic impact on what we provide young people. And that's sort of our role to facilitate their access. So that if you look at, you know, so the individual, yes, they're in there, the community, the family, they're all part of this model. And they're all looking for those seven factors, right, that we're talking about. And they're looking for resources, and they're looking for resources to be provided to them in meaningful ways that reflect their context and their culture. And ultimately, our job, I think, is to help them navigate and negotiate effectively. Now, if that's the model, I'm trying to find my cursor here. If that's the model, let me show you one little thing to make you woozy. It's a structural equation model. We spent almost 10 years developing this model. About $1 million went into it. It's pretty, eh? It looks like a parachute. I'm not going to go into it too much, except to say what this is about. These are kids. This is a model of older adolescents who are using lots of different services. These are kids at risk. And when we worked with these kids, there's almost 600 in this particular sample. We now have almost 7,000 in five countries that are part of the next wave of the study. And what they clearly showed was that kids don't get access to resources equally. Generally speaking, young people who are most marginalized, who have the least resources, who come from the most difficult families and communities, tend to get fewer services, which is a shame because they're the ones that need them the most. And we also found that, generally speaking, the young people who got lots and lots of services don't necessarily do better in life. So we were tracking service use, risk factors, resilience, and functional outcomes, like do you have high-risk sexual activity, are you abusing drugs, and all those kinds of things. And what we found clearly was some interesting takeaways. First of all, you have to reach out to the most vulnerable. The most vulnerable are not getting to your services. I hate to say that. It seems to be a universal truth across whether we're talking addiction services or we're talking mental health services. The most vulnerable do not get served. The second takeaway was stop flooding children or young people with services. More is not better. We've had this little thinking problem lately that if you keep giving kids lots of services that they're actually going to do better. But in fact, that's not the pattern we found. Young people who are giving more services did less well. What they want is one person to stick by them, to actually tell their story to once, to have facilitated access to all seven of those dimensions of their life, and then in partnership with all of you, to be given what they need to succeed. So if I was their financial counselor and they have a mental health problem, you're probably better than sending them for an assessment to actually be part of that treatment team that is in the cycle. It's not that you don't use the psychologist to do the psychological assessment. I'm not saying that. But you don't abandon them to the next system so they sort of hopscotch across the campus. That model will do more damage than good to kids, unfortunately. More services do not equal better mental health or better well-being or better resilience. In fact, it can actually be iatrogenic. It can harm young people. It's simply, so what we found instead was that when you have good service use experiences and you, through that one contact, develop access to feeling like you're connected, feeling powerful, feeling you have relationships, feeling a sense of cohesion in your life, feeling like you're being treated fairly and having someone in your corner and knowing it, generally speaking, you do much better. But of course, services are like boxes of Smarties on most campuses and most services, right? We scatter them across. Some people get the red ones. If you're at UPEI, maybe you have a green and a blue. If you're at Dalhousie, maybe you can have access to the purple and the red ones. I don't know what's here in your university. But the point is that you got to remember that you're going to want people have access to as many of these Smarties in that box as absolutely possible. So the exercise which I, we don't have time in this short keynote, in a sense, to do this. But the thing I usually would ask, if we had a day together, one of the things that I would do with you or encourage people to do in their teams would be to go through an appreciative inquiry. You see, I know when I'm invited in, I can tell you stories from other places and about other students that I've worked with and stuff, but ultimately it's about mining your own success stories. And I suspect at an institution of this size, you have lots of great success stories. I just love walking people through an appreciative inquiry process, which is basically those two questions, right? You describe an experience where you've had some impact, positive impact, on helping young people find those seven aspects of their lives, right? And then the second question, of course, is to answer, well, what exactly did the university or your unit or your employer or your supervisor or maybe you, what did you actually do so you can replicate that particular set of behaviors? That's really the key, right? Because if you're going to help people get to those seven balls, help them to juggle them, help work together, and you can't do it all alone, right? So you do need collaboration, not to say abandoning children so they hopscotch across seven services, but a collaborative effort that keeps the kid connected to one service provider somewhere who knows them, who can support them, who's in their corner, who's their advocate. That actually makes them much more resilient. Now, it's interesting. This notion of resilience is incredibly powerful. There's a lot of different threads on it, which I've been sort of hinting at. But you know, ultimately, it still comes down to this, right? And I do want to sort of preface this. I've been quoting a lot of research. I've been talking about my own research. I've been telling you about studies from around the globe. What's interesting is that a lot of that research comes out of basically a relatively homogeneous group of people, right? A very narrow group of people. And so a lot of those studies don't reflect many of the students that you have in your classrooms. For instance, I know that UBC prides itself on having a large Aboriginal population in your classrooms. You've had a very good outreach campaign, if I know some of your programs, certainly some of your satellite campuses and this type of thing. If that's the case, how much have we understood Aboriginal people's pathways to resilience? How have we understood their attachments to culture? Things that might be completely irrelevant to my children, aspects of resilience that might be completely irrelevant to them, might be highly relevant to other young people. Let me give you a small example very quickly. I think I have about two or three, a couple minutes. So years ago, I was working with a young person. Again, I started with a six-year-old. I know it didn't have much to do. I'm going to transfer you into another institutional setting, this time a jail, young offenders. So in my career, I also worked with a 17-year-old young fellow. He'd come off of an Aboriginal First Nations reserve in eastern Canada. And nobody had ever managed to get through this kid. This kid had suffered all the trauma from the leftovers, all that sort of traumatic across generations that had occurred after his parents had been taken forcibly to the residential schools, and they'd suffered through the whole cultural genocide that we had called education at one time. And what was interesting was that he had grown up in a very challenging environment and had adapted to it by becoming a real mean little effer, right? This kid he survived by using drugs and being violent and drinking heavily and all these other behaviors, and he got himself in trouble with the law for many, many years. And he'd spun his wheels through multiple times at a correctional facility. No one had ever really managed to reach him. Eventually, though, what happened was his treatment team kind of came together, and we were thinking about resilience and stuff, and we thought, well, let's get him involved in employment, right? And we were thinking very narrow, which I'm now ashamed to say. Oh, we'll get him a job. And if he connects to a job, then everything else will be better in his life. So we arranged for him to have a temporary absence from the secure custody facility. He was in there for some violent offenses. And he was going to go be placed with his uncle, who was a lobster fisherman on the east coast of Canada. Sounds good, right? They earn good money, all that kind of stuff. Now, the problem was, his uncle was a lobster fisherman in a place called Burnt Church, which was in an all-out warfare with a white community up the coast in New Brunswick, where they were actually literally firing, they were taking out guns and trying to kill each other. Lobster traps were being cut, and boats were being sunk. There was all-out warfare because the white community accused the First Nations community of taking more of the lobster stock than they were allowed to, this type of thing. Anyways, eventually the army got involved, the Coast Guard got involved, the RCMP got involved, and they suppressed the everybody, and they just said, look, all of you back into shore, no more fishing until you sort this out. That's the end of it. Well, into this mess is what we actually released this boy. And suddenly he's on a boat with his uncle who's defying the fishing moratorium. He's defying the army, the Navy, which has told them to push back into shore, and he's on his uncle's boat while they're going around the Gulf of St. Lawrence being chased by Coast Guard vessels which are firing live ammunition over the bow of the boat to get him to put back to shore. The kid comes back to custody a week later with his eyes like saucers. He is so turned on to life. Suddenly, he is feeling, as a young Aboriginal boy, a young First Nations kid in this country, he finally feels proud of who he is. He has connected to mentors. He has relationships with those, with the, you know, the warriors wearing the bandanas. He has stood up for his rights. He feels powerful. He has an identity. He has new relationships. He has cultural, a sense of his culture. He has a sense of belonging somewhere finally. He has access to a job in the future as a fisherman. We hit a home run. And so we are thinking afterwards, well, that's not a bad strategy. Next time, why don't we have another kid who's acting up? We'll just put him on a boat in the Gulf of St. Lawrence and have someone chase him with live ammunition firing at him. It doesn't work like that. What I do know is that the pathways to resilience are very, in a sense, culturally distinct, and we have to ask more than we have to tell. This is a photograph of my daughter early in the process of developing these ideas. Some of the research took place in a place like Tanzania. My daughter was with me when we were traveling, and she went to school for a few days with the children of my colleagues. My daughter, by the way, is just, if you want to pick her out, she's there in the white shirt. She's outnumbered on that bench, and I love ending on that note, is the fact that she is outnumbered. And I think the onus is for us to not assume that we understand resilience from everyone's perspective, but that very much resilience is something that we're still negotiating and trying to understand from the perspective of our many diverse students, whatever their backgrounds are. So with that note, I hope in some ways I maybe teased you to see that your work is incredibly important, especially in how you work together to meet the needs, that to embellish those factors that actually make kids, young people, resilient. It's not something just inside them, it's something that we collectively can influence. And with that, I wish you well in your work. Thank you very much for listening.